This video is about whole concept of pituitary surgery, and this is demonstration of surgical anatomy, Hadad flap, embryology, and whole anatomy of pituitary gland, so that anybody can do this pituitary surgery. For doing surgery, it is important to know the anatomy in detail, and you can see this picture showing anterior and posterior pituitary gland. So this pituitary gland having two parts. Main part is anterior gland and posterior part is small part, that is less important. And you can see this is whole pituitary gland anatomy with optic chiasm. So optic nerve is very important in surgical point of view. And this is bright spot in MRI T1 weighted imaging of normal posterior pituitary, you can see as a bright spot, and anterior pituitary as isointense, same as the brain. And this is post contrast imaging, you can see whole gland is hyper intense in the section, it is oval and rectangular shape. The transfer diameter is almost 1.5 to 2 times higher than the height of the pituitary gland. So you can see this is carotid siphon both sides. You can see the siphon showing four cobras. And this again bright spot in post contrast MRI. And this is pituitary adenoma. You can see this is very large adenoma on the MRI T1 weighted image. Again, this is T1 image post contrast showing hyper intense lesion, that is microadenoma in this.
Hi guys, now we will talk about development of pituitary gland. As you know, pituitary gland has two parts. Anterior pituitary, and this is posterior pituitary. Okay, this is third ventricle or hypothalamus. This is optic chiasm and this is mammary bones. Okay, now anterior pituitary, you can say it's adeno hypophysis, developed from roof of primitive oral cavity. The adenohypophysis developed from group of primitive cavity, also called stromerium. That structure is called Rathke pouch. Rathke's pouch. Also, this is oral cavity, and one part of this evaginate. It's called Rathke pouch. On third week, this Rathke pouch develop as a anterior pituitary. So anterior pituitary develop from roof of the primitive oral cavity, stromerium, or so called Rathke pouch. Now this posterior pituitary develop from evagination from diencephalon, which form infundibulum, ultimately convert into this infundibulum, develop first on 3rd to 4th week, ultimately form to neurohypophysis, or called posterior pituitary. It it is just a extension of the diencephalon, just like retina is also extension of diencephalon. This is also developed from diencephalon as infantilum, ultimately developed to neurohypophysis. This is all about development. So this is having parts all I have already discussed in fifth video. Thank you so much. Hi guys, this is Dr. Surini Sharma, consultant of ENT in headache department. Now, this is my fifth video about decoding head and neck for ENT PGs and NEET PGs. Okay. Now we will talk about pituitary gland, also called hypophysis cerebri. Okay. Now this pituitary gland is oval shape. P-sized. Okay. This is oval shape P-sized gland, which is situated in the cella tarsica. Okay. Situated in the cella tarsica. If you see, this is the cella tarsica situated in the body of sphenoid sinus. Okay. This depression is called cella tarsica. This is posterior clinoid process. These are the anterior clinoid process. In between, it is situated. Okay. Now, we will talk about dimensions of pituitary gland. If you see, transverse diameter is about 12 mm. Okay. This diameter is called transverse diameter is about 12 mm. If we see anteroposterior diameter, anterior posterior diameter is about 8 mm. Okay, if we anteroposterior diameter 8 mm, if we see the height is about 4 mm. So, overall dimension is transfer diameter 12 mm, T transfer diameter into 8 mm, AP diameter. And height is 4 mm. Okay, this is all dimension of normal pituitary gland. In pregnancy, it may increase female greater than male. Pregnancy size is increased. Okay, now weight is 500 milligram. The normal pituitary gland weight is 500 milligram. If we see weight of thyroid gland, I just want to discuss this. You normally ask, thyroid gland weight is about 25 gram and parathyroid gland weight is about normal gland 30 milligram. So you have to remember this. Now color of pituitary gland is reddish gray color. So this is all about normal dimension, oval shape, P size, reddish gray, situated in cella tarsica, 12 transfer diameter 8 mm, AP diameter height is 4 mm, weight is 500 milligram. If you compare with thyroid gland, it's 25 gram weight of thyroid gland, parathyroid having 30 milligram. These are most commonly asked questions, dimension, MCQ and weight. Okay. Now we will talk about parts of the pituitary glands. Parts of pituitary gland. It having two parts. One is called anterior pituitary, also called adenohypophysis. Second is, this is anterior pituitary. and this is posterior pituitary. And second one is posterior pituitary. Also called neurohypophysis because it's developed from the central part, CNS, from the diencephalon. That's why it's called neurohypophysis. And this is called adenohypophysis. Now we will talk about parts of the gland. Anterior pituitary having three parts. This anterior pituitary having three parts. If you see this part of anterior pituitary, this is called pars tuberalis. This part, big part, is called pars anterior or pars distalis. It's distal from the CNS brain, that's a distalis. Most distal part, that is called distalis, and most large part of pars anterior or pars distalis. And this is cleft, that is called intraglandular cleft. Behind this, this part between the neurohypophysis and adenohypophysis is called intermediate pars intermediate or intermediate pituitary of anterior part, pars intermediate. So these are three part of the or pars intermedia. You can call this pars intermedia. Okay, so these are the three parts. Pars, one part is pars anterior, pars distalis, second part is pars tuberalis, and pars intermedia is third. These are part of the anterior pituitary. Now we will talk about posterior pituitary. Posterior pituitary also having three parts. If you see this, most rostral part of tuber cinereum is part of hypothalamus, is called median eminence. This stalk is called infundibulum, from which this posterior gland is developed, infundibulum. And this main part, this whole main part, is called pars nervosa. Okay, so anterior pituitary having three parts, pars tuberalis, pars anterior, pars distalis, or pars intermedia. And posterior pituitary also having three parts, median eminence, infundibulum, and pars nervosa. Okay, this developed from this CNS brain, diencephalon, that's why it's called pars nervosa. Okay, now we will talk about blood supply. Blood supply of anterior of pituitary. Arterial supply. This whole anterior posterior pituitary gland supply by the, see this is superior hypophyseal artery. There may be many numbers, 2 or 3, but mainly in 1 or 2. So this is hypophyseal artery, mainly supply the posterior part of the infundibulum, median eminence. And if you see from here, one artery, single artery on each side. So total of two single arteries, inferior hypophyseal artery. Both are branch of internal carotid artery. Both cavernous part of superior and inferior hypophyseal arteries are branch of the ICL. Cavernous part of the cavernous part of the ICA, internal carotid artery. Okay, these may be multiple number 2 or 3, but this artery is single on each side. It's also like this, it's coming from each side here. This is cavernous sinus here, if you see, and this is cavernous sinus. So one artery is coming inferior, hypophyseal coming from here, from cavernous part of ICA, and one artery, inferior artery coming from here. But superior may be multiple in number. Okay, then connecting artery between two is called trabecular artery. Trabecular arteries. This artery. This anterior pituitary is don't have any direct supply from either superior hypophyseal artery or inferior hypophyseal artery. But it supply by portal venous connection. Okay, this vein form the capillary plexus. This artery drained by capillary plexus. So there is a multiple capillary plexus here. This is called here in median eminence and frontal primary capillary plexus, and this here, this is secondary capillary plexus from inferior hypophyseal artery, which ultimately form the capillaries and ultimately drain into venous sinuses, dural venous sinuses. So this supply by portal veins. Portal veins. It may be long short portal veins coming from median eminence, formed by the capillaries of this superior hypophyseal artery, and may coming from directly from infundibulum, that is short portal vein. This is also called hypophyseal portal system. Okay, this is called hypophyseal portal system. So this is all about blood supply, venous drainage by venous sinuses. It may be anterior or posterior intercavernous sinuses, or maybe superior or inferior cavernous intercavernous sinuses. Okay. Now detail, if you see, this is anterior pituitary and this is posterior pituitary. If you see where it is situated in the sella turcica here. Okay, now what are the structure surrounding it? If you see superiorly, this is third ventricle. Here is, you can see sphenosinus. So structure above, below and laterally, you can see superiorly and inferiorly structure. If you see inferior, intro inferior part, you can see sphenoid sinus, enter cavernous sinus and sella turcica, floor of sella turcica, where it is situated. three structure we have, cella turcica, entercavernous xylus and sphenoid xylus are below the pituitary gland. If you see above, you can see median eminence above superiorly. Median eminence, third ventricle, this is optic chiasma, anterosuperior, optic chiasma, anterosuperiorly optic chiasma, posteriorly you can see memory bodies or tuber scenarium, part of hypothalamus, tuber scenarium. These are superiorly. If you see laterally, now we examine both laterally, what are the structure lateral to the both both side on either side of the pituitary gland. If you see, I am drawing the antero posterior version. If you see, this is the pituitary gland, this is cella turcica, this is the sphenoid xylus, sphenoid ear cells, sphenoid ear cells. If you see this side, on either side of pituitary gland, you can see this is a cavernous sinus and the structure related to cavernous sinus. So both side you can see cavernous sinus. Now content of cavernous sinus is also lateral to this. If you see, this is the ICA, cavernous ICA, intercontractile. Below this you can find in cavernous sinus infomedially is abducens, sixth nerve, and lateral the other nerves which are going through superior orbital fissure are not the content of cavernous sinus, they are lateral to it. If you see, this is the oculomotor nerve, third nerve, fourth nerve, this is V1, V2, V1 goes to, that is ophthalmic goes to the optic nerve, ophthalmic branch, V2 and this is V1 and V2. Okay, and maxillary division goes, that mandibular division in the foramen ovale. So this is the sequence. If you see oculomotor, trochlear and this V1, that is ophthalmic, and V2 is the maxillary in the lateral wall of cavernous sinus. So laterally you can see cavernous sinus both side, cavernous sinus and content ICA and sixth nerve, and lateral to cavernous sinus you can also find third, fourth, V1 and V2. These are the structures. When we are doing transsphenoidal pituitary surgery, we have to know the surgical anatomy. Very important, surgical anatomy. This is very important when you are operating transnasally, transsphenoidal pituitary hypophysectomy. Okay, this is called transsphenoid hypophysectomy. Transsphenoidal hypophysectomy. When we are operating, we are removing the pituitary tumor. Okay, these are the structure lateral to the pituitary gland. As you know, this pituitary gland is also called master gland of endocrine. It means it control the secretion of other endocrine glands, but true master, you can say true master, or you can say headmaster, is actually hypothalamus. hypothalamus. This hypothalamus not only control the endocrine, this pituitary gland, it's also control so many things like food intake, behavior. Water intake. So this also not control the anterior pituitary gland or posterior pituitary, this also control the behavioral changes, food intake and water intake. So many other hormonal control, autonomic nervous system also controlled by this hypothalamus. Now, we will talk about posterior pituitary. See, this is optic chiasma. This is posterior pituitary. This posterior pituitary does not secrete any hormone directly. It's all hormone coming from this is supra optic nuclei hypothalamus and hypothalamus which form the this is you can say soma and this form the large axon that is called magna cellular axons. Okay. And this lobe, the end point form lobe that is called herring bodies. This is also MCQs. This is granule which contains some hormone that is called oxytocin. Supraoptic nuclei secrete, ADH hormone, antidiuretic, vasopressin or ADH hormone. Similar to this, we have another nuclei like this is paraventricular nuclei. This also having magna cellular axons. This knob-like structure also called herring body. This secrete paraventricular nuclei secrete the oxytocin hormone. Okay, these two main hormones, which oxytocin is also called milk ejection hormone because it contracts the myofascial cell of the mammary glands and also called birth hormone, which contracts the uterine cavity, uterine muscles during birth of the baby. This antidiuretic hormone is mainly act as water retention or decrease urine volume, which act on the vasopressor 2-type receptor on distal collecting tubule of kidney. Mira receptor also called BR2 receptor, which act vasopressin there and it's retain the water, which decrease the water urine output. That's why increase the, and this is called antidiuresis. It means it increase the water volume and that's why it's increase the pressure also. Increase the pressure, that's why it's called vasopressin. Okay. Now we will talk about anterior pituitary. Anterior pituitary gland. This having three part, tuberalis, this distalis or this pars intermedia. this distal is male part. Okay, the anterior pituitary parts enter media, or in woman it don't secrete any hormone. Mainly in amphibian, if you see parts enter media, parts enter media. In amphibian mainly secrete melanocyte stimulating hormone, but in woman it's not functioning. It's coming from directly from corticotrophs of the this distalis part. Okay. If we histologically we can see this anterior pituitary having two types of cells. The cell which having granule and stain is called chromophyll cells, and which does not stain is called chromophore cells. It's about almost 50% this anterior pituitary having chromophylls and 50% having this chromophore cells. The most common tumor in pituitary is non-functioning adenoma. It does not secrete any. It's MCQ also. Most common tumor in pituitary is non-functioning adenoma. Second most common in pituitary is, if you see, it's called pituitary prolactinoma. If somebody asks what is the most common tumor is non-functioning adenoma, and second benign is most common benign tumor is prolactinoma. Okay, so if MCQ is given non-functioning adenoma in option, so then go for non-functioning adenoma. If it is there is non-functioning adenoma not there, then we go for pituitary prolactinoma is most common tumor in adults. Now, what are the hormones which are secreted by the anterior pituitary glands? Anterior pituitary hormones. Growth hormone. Prolactin. Hormone, FSH, LH hormone, thyroid stimulating hormone, and adrenocorticotropic hormone. These are the six hormones secreted by the anterior pituitary gland. This growth hormone, if it is deficient, may cause dwarfism. If it is sufficient increase like growth hormone adenoma, then in children it may cause gigantism. In adult, because if its growth hormone mainly act on the this is bone and this is epiphyseal plate. If once this fuse with bone after adult, so there is no growth on height. That's why it's adult, there is no gigantism, there is acromegaly. Increase wide bones and soft tissue growth. Okay, now prolactin is also polypeptide hormone. It is also secreted by the anterior pituitary. This prolactin is only this growth hormone having hypothalamic control, like growth hormone, releasing hormone, also have growth hormone, inhibiting hormone. But this prolactin having only inhibitory component, hypothalamus inhibitory control, that is called prolactin lactin inhibitory hormone. So if there is any injury of stalk, any injury of stalk will lead to hypersecretion of prolactin. Rest of the things will be same, but if injury of the this pituitary stalk may lead to hyperprolactinemia because of only having inhibitory control by the hypothalamus by dopamine. By dopamine. That's why we are in prolactinoma, we are giving dopamine agonist like bromocriptine and ergolins. That's why we are giving these medicines because they are dopamine agonists, that's why active in prolactin tumors. Now, second FSH, LH, these two hormones, growth hormone prolactin secreted by acidophilic cells. Acidophilic cells, they are orange in color. Which orange G, stain with orange G or eosin. They may be orange to pink color. And these four hormone is secreted by basophil cells. Basophil cells. They stain by the pars, periodic acid sieve or hematoxylin. You know. Stains. Poorly stained by hemotoxylin, but better stained with periodic acid sieve. Okay. These are blue color. B4 basophil blue in stain. Okay. Acidophilic cells having growth hormone, also called somatotrophs. This also called lactotrophs. And both sometime having combined secretion somatolactotrophs. And this is called gonadotrophs, gonadotroph cells. This is thyrotrophs, thyrotroph cells. And this is called corticotrophs, corticotrophs. It's also controlled by the corticotropin releasing hormone by hypothalamus. This controlled by the thyrotropic releasing hormone by the hypothalamus. This controlled by the gonadotropic releasing hormone and inhibitory hormone from the hypothalamus. Okay. If you see acidophilic cells are growth hormone, prolactin hormone, and basophil cells secrete thyroid stimulating hormone, follicular stimulating hormone, LH hormone, adrenocorticotropic hormone. These four hormones and these two total hormones secreted by anterior 6. These two hormones are polypeptide, and these four hormones are glycopeptide, also called trophic hormone, because they control other endocrine glands to secrete hormones. They directly act on the cells and they directly act, indirectly act through other endocrine glands. That's why it's called trophic hormone. This thyroid stimulating hormone act on the thyroid gland. This follicular stimulating hormone and LH hormone act on like Sertoli cell, follicular stimulating hormone, Sertoli cell. Of in male enhance the spermatogenesis. This LH in male act on the leading cells. This is also MCQ. Follicular stimulating hormone male act on the Sertoli cells, which increase the spermatogenesis. This LH in male also called interstitial cell, stimulating hormone act on leading cell which increase the testosterone secretion. Okay, this FSH again I am telling you act on Sertoli cells in male, and in females act on the follicles of ovary which increase the estrogen secretion. And ultimately, follicle tunnel corpus luteum also acts corpus luteum is secret progesterone. Same way, luteinizing hormone also acts on the corpus luteum in female, which increase the progesterone secretion. That is also called LH surge. And this LH in male also called interstitial cell stimulating hormone, which acts on leading cell, which ultimately testosterone. Why this is polypeptide? Because it's formed by 191 amino acids, and this formed by 198 amino acids. It's single chain polypeptide. This formed by the glycoprotein 7-2 part. Alpha chain is same in all three TSH, FH, LH, ACTH, which formed by the 89 amino acids. And this beta chain is different in each, like then beta FSH LH is formed by the 115 amino acids, and TSH alpha is 89 but beta is 112 amino acids TSH beta unit. And same ACTH also polypeptide, it's not glycopeptide, it's also polypeptide made by the 89 amino acids. It's a single chain also. Okay, this is all about hormones. Now we will talk about some important point like neurohypophysin. What is neurohypophysin? Neurohypophysin is transport protein. This is posterior pituitary, and this here is cells paraventricular supra optic nuclei. This here is hearing bodies. This hormone oxytocin and ADH transported through protein in the hearing granule is called neurohypophysin protein. Neurohypophysin, you can write it neurohypophysin protein. This is called magna cellular axons. They are large, that's why it's called magna. This is all about pituitary gland, and next time we will discuss about skull base, anterior posterior middle, and middle divided into sagittal, parasagittal, and all this. Thank you so much.
Hi guys, this is central skull base lesion. This is pituitary adenoma MRI T2 weighted image showing large 4x2 cm adenoma in the central skull base or cella turcica. And this having cystic and soft component as showing in the picture. The overwhelming majority of pituitary adenoma are benign, present either with characteristic syndrome of excess hormone secretion or secondary to mass effect by the growing tumor. And this adenoma is more than 4 cm, so it is giant macroadenoma. And this patient present with characteristic bitemporal anopia with headache. The pituitary adenoma may be classified according to their clinical and radiological finding. And according to their cell lineage, those tumors that measure less than 10 mm in diameter are considered macroadenoma. If tumor is more than 10 mm, it is macroadenoma. These macroadenoma, if exceed size of more than 4 cm, as this tumor is called giant pituitary adenoma. So initially it is two types, microadenoma and macroadenoma, but if it is more than 4 cm macroadenoma is called giant adenoma. And according to their function and secretory function, it may be functioning macroadenoma or it may be non-functioning adenoma. So depends which hormone they are secreting or not. According to that, we can classify these functioning and non-functioning adenoma. The effective medical therapy is available for prolactin secreting adenoma and other tumors required transspinodal surgery is the first line management, as in this case this is non-functioning adenoma we are doing for mass effect. And now I am elevating the Haddad flap on the left side so that reconstruction can be done with the Haddad flap, and I am using monopolar cautery for Haddad flap elevation. And this is sphenodosteum. I have already reached to the sphenodosteum. Now I will elevate this Haddad flap, and size of the flap depend on the bony defect of the cella turcica. Pituitary adenoma account for approximately 10-15% of surgically treated primary tumors of central nervous system. The incidence appear higher in African Americans, and adenoma account for 20% of non-metastatic CNS tumors. Incidence rate of pituitary tumors is about 3 in 1 lakh. The majority of these tumors are about 3-5 mm in diameter and would not require any medical and surgical intervention. And most these recent studies suggest the healthy subject also having 10% population harbor these lesions, but they are asymptomatic. And these are common in women of childbearing age, and that despite having male-female ratio is equal. Among the varying class of adenoma, prolactinoma and non-functioning adenoma have the highest incidence. First prolactinoma, then non-functioning adenoma, then other type of like growth hormone leading to acromegaly and gonadotrophs. These are the other types of the secretory adenomas. First is prolactinoma, then non-secretory, then other type of the secretory adenomas. The prolactin secreting adenomas comprise about 40-60% of functioning adenoma and are most common subtype of pituitary tumor diagnosed in adolescents. Majority of macroadenoma occurs in women with their second and third decades. Men generally present later in their fourth or fifth decades, almost always with macroadenoma. In men, it is most likely if it is in the fourth or fifth decade, it is macroadenoma, as this case is male patient about 50 years of age. The growth hormone secreting adenoma represents approximately 20-30% of functioning tumors. Nearly 3/4 of growth hormone secreting adenoma are macroadenoma. Approximately 40-60% individual of acromegaly between mostly present between 3rd and 5th decade. Acromegaly has been associated with increased incidence of cardiovascular, respiratory and cerebrovascular disease, and as well as increased risk of colon cancer. So acromegaly, you have to rule out the colon cancer and other cardiac complication by 2D echo or other intervention. The ACTH secreting adenoma accounts about 15-25% of all functioning adenoma and are most common pituitary tumor diagnosed in prepubertal children. In children, ACTH adenoma are more common. The majority of ACTH adenomas, regardless of age, are microadenomas. Approximately 39 individuals per million present with Cushing disease and causes ACTH secreting adenoma. And Cushing disease is also common in women, most of whom present during 3rd and 4th decade. And if they present with this ACTH secreting adenoma, most likely have hypertension and diabetic mellitus. The increasing number of adenoma are diagnosed incidentally during evaluation of trauma, stroke and other brain evaluation. Visual deficit present between 5-15% of cases and 50% with formal testing will represent with headache. More than 1/3 are macroadenoma and rest are microadenoma. In some small asymptomatic incidental microadenoma has been identified. Now this Haddad flap is already elevated. Now I am widening this sphenoid sinus ostium. Now some talk about hypersecreting syndromes. Acromegaly induced characteristic growth hormone induces structural changes in the physiology. There is incidence of coarsening of facial feature with enlarged forehead, enlarged tongue, malocclusion of teeth and prognathism. Patient hand and feet are very large. Patient may present with excessive sweating, hyperhidrosis, external hypertrophy of tissue is parallel throughout the body. Enlargement of tongue and hands is common. Patient may suffer from enlarged organ visceromegaly and overgrowth of joints and cartilage, along with high blood pressure, cardiomyopathy, congestive heart failure, sleep apnea, and spinal canal narrowing. That is called facet hypertrophy. In carpal tunnel syndrome, significant number of patient acromegaly also have impaired glucose metabolism, may present with diabetes mellitus. Now, I am widening this sphenoid sinus ostium with sphenoid punch. After doing left side, I will elevate from the right side. Women with prolactinomas classically present with amenorrhea, oligomenorrhea and galactorrhea. Most are there in childbearing years and most likely having medical attention due to infertility or menstrual irregularities. And they may present with headache and visual symptoms because of mass effect. And some having sexual dysfunction because of decreased pituitary function. Amenorrhea and galactorrhea are not specific to prolactinomas. prolactin secreting tumor is under constant inhibitory control from the hypothalamus. Any lesion that imposes pressure upon the portal venous connection of pituitary stalk infundibulum connecting the hypothalamus with the pituitary gland can interrupt the hypothalamus and inhibit dopaminergic signal. That inhibitory effect of dopaminergic is disrupted, thus the increased serum prolactin level and lead to prolactinoma and may lead to the hypersecretion of prolactin. The neurological dysfunction develop as adenoma if it grow beyond the salatorsica and exert pressure on adjacent brain structures. On visual acuity, this pressure lead to bitemporal hemianopia, visual loss in temporal field of each eye. Tumor growth may also affect other nerve, third, fourth, fifth and sixth, if tumor grow in the cavernous sinus which is adjacent to it. Now I am cutting this terminate on the right side so that exposure should be bad. The headache, although a non-specific complaint, can occur when a tumor stretch in dural sac that surround the pituitary gland. Headache from pituitary lesion is usually frontal or retroorbital. It may be bitemporal or radiate to occipito-cervical region. The diagnosis of this central scalp region required serum GH, prolactin, insulin growth factor 1, galactron, LHRH, LHFSH investigation and ACTH and 24-hour urine free cortisol level evaluation as well as CT and MRI. CT for nasal phase of bony anatomy and sphenoid sinus anatomy, like it is conchal, precellar or cellar type of sphenoid sinus. And MRI for the central lesion, it is soft, hard or any, to rule out any other alternative diagnosis. Now treatment. Although some incidentally discovered microadenoma that do not require having any symptom, do not require any treatment, and these should be followed by serial MRI investigation according to need of the symptoms. Now talk about medical therapy. Medical therapy is available for most hypersecretory tumors. The majority of prolactin secreting adenoma are effectively treated with dopamine agonist like cabergoline and bromocriptine. Cabergoline is generally effective about 90% of cases and that achieve hormone control. And surgical intervention is ordinary reserved for those who are intolerant to medical therapy and having pressure symptom or mass effect. The medical treatment using somatostatin analogs like octreotide, lanreotide, pasireotide and dopamine agonistic cabergoline has been varying efficacy in GH adenomas. The growth hormone receptor antagonist pegbisamant can be used in combination with other agent. And hormonal control can generally be achieved in about 60-90% of the patient. Although medical therapy is most often reserved for those patients awaiting surgery or those with persistent disease postoperatively. The ketoconazole or metirapone can be used in Cushing disease which having ACTH secreting tumor. Now I am widening the right sided sphenoidosteum so that exposure and doing posterior septectomy by using bipolar cautery so that bleeding should not be there during widening of spin out sinus. Radiation surgery, most radiotherapy mostly employed in conjunction medical and surgical therapy. Functional external beam radiotherapy can reduce excessive hormone production and can reduce the size of the tumor. If tumor is non-resectable, having invasion of major stick like carotid and optic, then you can think about radiation therapy, and that is invasive tumor required radiation therapy. Indications for surgery. For most pituitary tumors, surgery remains the first line treatment for symptomatic pituitary adenomas. Large or invasive asymptomatic tumors may also warrant surgical consideration. It is sometimes possible to estimate tumor's invasiveness on MRI using the KNOSP grading system. KNOSP, KNOSP grading system, is having three lines. One is medial to carotid, in between the carotid and lateral to carotid. These lines decide the possible tumor invasion. The asymptomatic tumors with evidence of radiographic invasion or displacement of optic apparatus may benefit from surgery to prevent neurological deficit and progressive pituitary dysfunction. And surgery also chosen if medical treatment is failed. Regardless of tumor type, surgery provides prompt relief from excess hormone secretion and mass effect. There is evidence to suggest that debulking of medically refractory prolactinoma and GH adenoma can return these tumors to responsiveness state about 60% of the cases. Surgery may be indicated in pituitary apoplexy with acute vision loss within 72 hours as a result of mass effect or optic chiasm hematoma formation. In T2-weighted image, you can measure the intracarotid distance, which is KNOSP classification, and you can stage the tumor. Postoperative management varies from routine to very complicated, depending on lesion size, extent of operation, and postoperative pituitary function. Patient with complete removal of intracellular non-functioning tumor, intraoperative preservation of normal pituitary without a CSF leak can have relatively benign postoperative course. It is important to monitor closely DI, diabetic insipidus, check fasting or normal cortisol level to rule out secondary adrenal insufficiency. Restrict fluid as appropriate to prevent the syndrome of inappropriate antidiuretic hormone, SIADS, so you can prevent by fluid restriction. Patient with larger supracellular or invasive tumors, those with CSF leaks require more extensive skull base reconstruction. As this tumor is large, I will reconstruct with the septal cartilage, septal bone with Harrod flap, so that there will be no chance of CSF leak. Now, surgical technique. The minimally invasive transsphenoidal approach can be effective in 90% of the pituitary tumors. Exceptions are large tumor with extent beyond the carotid and optic nerve in the lateral extension. And occasionally combined approach is used, like transsphenoidal plus transcranial. Combined approach has been applied in extensive tumors.
This transsphenoidal approach can be done with endoscope and microscope. So endoscope is better, as we are using endoscope so that you can see each and every structure in detail, and you can have better control of major structures. The role of neuro navigation is mostly in recurrent adenoma or in conical type of cella, conical type of sphenoidosinus. In these type of cases, conical type is very difficult, which about 3% of the cases. Most common is cellar type, which is about 90% of cases. This is cellar type of sphenoidosinus. You can see large sphenoidosinus on the left side, right sphenoidosinus is smaller than the left. And in this case, if you see the MRI, there is tumor more on the right side. But cella is quite enlarged, the gap between intercarotid distance about 2.5 centimeters. So you can have better access to remove this tumor through this cellar approach. So operating these tumor is, there is three stages. First is nasal stage. In nasal stage, if any deviation to particular side, if your access is affected, then you can correct the deviation, you can correct the conchal or terminate hypertrophy, then proceed to the sphenoidosinus. Before doing that, if you required sphenoidosinus, the cellar reconstruction, if tumor is larger, then you can have Harrod flap or rescue flap, depending on the defect of the cella. So first stage is nasal stage. Second stage is cellar stage. In cellar stage, you have to rule out a CT scan which type of sphenoidosinus you are facing to. If it is conchal type, cellar type, and pre-cellar type. The conchal type, there is no pneumatization of cella, sphenoidosinus. It means there is thick bone before the cella, and it's very difficult to operate without navigation. So you don't have any anatomical landmark to proceed to cella. In pre-cellar and cellar type, you can proceed to the cella because it's easily identifiable, the landmark in the intra-sphenoidal sinus region. Now third stage is cellar stage, in which you have to remove the pre-cellar bone or inferior floor of the cella. Then you can proceed to remove the tumor depending on the consistency of the tumor. Now, the pure endoscopic approach has been much appeal. It's becoming the procedure of choice in many pituitary centers. And we have done more than 100 cases in our center. So, at Rajasthan Hospital, Sahiba. And we are using binostral approach, which having 200 micro dissection approach and 200 suction and visualization approach, so that there will be 4 end to operate, 2 neurosurgeon, 2 end of neurosurgeon, 2 end of ENT surgeon. So you can easily remove the tumor. The surgical outcomes after surgery for pituitary adenoma can be divided into functioning outcome and oncological outcome. Functional goal include the relief of symptoms and improvement of preservation of pituitary and visual function, along with improved quality of life. Visual deficit in patient with non-functioning pituitary adenoma are improved in approximately 80 to 90% of the cases. In some visual, deterioration may occur in 0 to 4% of the cases. Most patients with intact pituitary function preoperatively retain their normal function. Those with preoperative pituitary deficiency regain function in about 27% of the cases. And remaining cases we have to manage with hormone replacement therapy, HRT. The oncological outcome relate to tumor resection, recurrence, biochemical remissions from hormonal access. 10-year recurrence rate are approximately 16%, although only 6% require additional treatment. In long-term follow-up, 83% of patients are alive and well without evidence of any recurrence in any disease. Patients with prolactinoma who present with surgery are most often those who failed medical treatment. Endonasal surgery for prolactinoma is associated with additional risk resulting from tumor fibrosis after dopamine agonist therapy, but remission rate are still quite good. And prolactin level returned to normal in about 87% of the macroadenoma and 56% of the macroadenoma. Now, complication of transsphenoidal surgery. Complication abundance is central to transsphenoidal approach. Recently, surgical checklist of every step you should check out. The major morbidity may be CSF leak, meningitis, stroke, intracranial hemorrhage and visualize. So, these five complications, CSF leak, meningitis, stroke, intracranial hemorrhage and visual loss, are common complications and major complications. Less or mild complications are sinus disease, synechia formation, nasal septal deep perforation, and wound infection like wound adhesions or abscess formation in the sinuses. So these are the common complications. Now I am removing the sphenoid mucosa so that bone of the cellar region can be exposed completely. So, and I will remove this intrasphenoidal septum also so that it is wide exposure more than enough. Sometimes you require exposure of 1.5 cavity. You have to include the posterior eighth mode. In this case, I don't require exposure of posterior eighth mode because this is sufficient exposure to deal with this tumor as large size of sphenoid sinus so that we can remove without exposing the posterior eighth mode in this case. On conclusion, the pituitary adenoma are complex set of benign tumors that present with characteristic hypersecretory syndrome and mass effect. Although medical and radiotherapy offer effective treatment for particular functional tumor in specific situation, transsphenoidal surgery continue to provide optimal outcome for non-prolactin secreting adenomas with low incidence of major complications. So this is basic about pituitary adenoma. Now I have removed mucosa of these sinuses. In 1893, Caton and Paul attempted to explore cella turcica by lateral subtemporal route along with orbital excentration. Sublabial approach was adopted by Cushing in 1910. The transsphenoidal route was re-evaluated by Guot and Hardy. Bisser, Hardy and Guot are the transsphenoidal initial history surgeons. So there is two routes, extracranial and transcranial. The transcranial route are subfrontal, pterygonal, orbital zygomatic approach and subtemporal. So these four approaches, subfrontal, pterion, orbitozygomatic, in subtemporal. So transspinodal approach can be by sublabial approach, transnasal, transeptal, transspinodal approach, transmaxillary, transethmoidal, and transspinodal approach. And sometimes we use frontoorbital external transspinodal approach in tumor which extend anteriorly. And this transspinodal approach can be done with microscope or endoscope. And transcranial approach if tumor is large size which extend lateral to the carotid. The following three anatomical concepts that are fundamental to the safe execution of transspinodal procedure. First is pituitary gland is an extra arachnoid structure. Two is pituitary gland is strictly in the midline, which hazard to either side, prevent hazards to either side. And third is important to recognize the residual normal anterior pituitary, which may affect your functioning of the hormones. The transspinodal operation for the removal of pituitary adenoma should be executed with respect of preservation of integrity of the arachnoid membrane, which act as protective shield between the surgical manipulation and subarachnoid space and vital neurovascular structure. Thus, the surgical dissection should be performed along with tumor arachnoid interface. So try to not to breach the arachnoid. Should be done so you can prevent from CSF leak as well as you are away from neurovascular structure. The indication of transnasal approaches are most pituitary tumors, craniopharyngioma and other lesion primarily in the cella, Rathke cleft cyst and apoplexy in the central skull base tumor. Now I have done this exposure of the cellar floor, removed the bone, and this exposure the anatomy of sphenoid sinus, as you can see this picture, the sphenoid sinus in 46% of time septum is away from the midline. And Hamburger classification, the Hamburger classified the sphenoid sinus in three types. Conical, this is about 3%. Pre-cellar is about 25%. In cellar is about 70% or more than that. And carotid bulge in cellar type, you can see about 71% of the cases in the supralateral walls of the sphenoid sinus. Normal intercarotid distance in normal pituitary is about 12 mm, but in this case where the tumor is enlarged is about 2.5 cm. You can have this by MRI or CT scan, you can judge the exact distance of intercarotid distance so that your central axis should be wide enough to access the pituitary central lesion. The normal preoperative evaluation are CT PNS, MRI brain, complete hormone evaluation, visual acuity and visual field charting, and nasal swab testing to rule out any prior sinusitis, or CBC to rule out any infection, and pre-op measure for doing PTA, PTT, all this for the surgery. Now this cella is exposed and we are removing the keel so that exposure should be wide enough to access this tumor. And dura open in cruciate manner, and you can open dura in C shape also, depend on the and you can make flap, but if you are using hardware flap that is not needed. When removing a macroadenoma that is visible either on the surface or through the much distended layer of normal pituitary, look the cleavage plane between the macroadenoma and the residual normal pituitary so that pituitary function can be restored. Prefer the use of loop curettes to ring curettes because the absence of any sharp edges prevent the injury to major surrounding structures. The recognition of the arachnoid, which is usually covered by thin layer of residual normal anterior pituitary, is a critical point in the operation. Failure to identify the arachnoid and distinguish it from the surrounding suprasellar tumor can lead to penetration to the subarachnoid space with the possibility of injuring the subarachnoid neurovascular structures. Now we have reached to the cella. You can see in this picture. Now we will use bipolar cautery so that we can have the hemostasis properly, and after exposing this bone we will cut by bipolar and we can make cruciate incision on the dural surface of this tumor. And this defect can be closed by this fat, then abgel, then use bone flap that I will use in this case, and you can use Haddad flap after that and you apply that, so there will be no chance of CSF leak. So what are the common other complications like septal perforation, deviated nasal septum, nasal blockage, crusting, hormone imbalance, CSF rhinorrhea, apoplexy, residual tumor, hypoosmia, and gingival numbness can be occur. Now you can see clearly the dura, and I am removing this lateral part of the bony part of this tumor. Better to remove with sphenoid punch. The remaining dura can be shrunk with bipolar coagulation. So we will use the bipolar coagulation in this case. The dissection of dura tumor again proceed along with tumor arachnoid interface, with goal always being maintain the integrity of arachnoid membrane. The advantage of endoscopic approach are it is simpler procedure, wide angle of operation, you can see widely field is wide, more safer and identified major structure is less traumatic and it is less time consuming. The indications for transcranial approaches, like if tumor is dumbbell shaped adenoma with severe constriction at the diaphragmatic cella, and this tumor is mostly supracellular and lateral to carotid, required this transcranial approach. If the supracellular component of adenoma is inaccessible because cella has not enlarged, then you have to do transcranial approach. Approximately 70% of pituitary adenoma with homogeneous isointense signal on T2-weighted MRI are firm and fibrotic. If any region in this central scalvus lesion, if you see in T2-weighted MRI, if they are homogeneous and isointense, they are more likely firm and fibrotic and difficult to remove. This is unedited video of this pituitary adenoma surgery. Now this is wide exposure of cella and this is dura. Now this reconstruction of this skull base should be watertight reconstruction. Now we are doing bipolar cautery of this cella. And after we will make cruciate incision. In summary, I can say the recent advance in technology and endoscopic skull based surgical techniques and neuroimaging has allowed us to do safe and efficacious treatment of pituitary lesions, central skull base. And hormonal evaluation, you can exactly identify the tumor type and intervention of medical or surgical intervention of radiology or any, so that your management will be proper. Now we are making incision on the dura. Now you can see tumor is coming out because it's already having soft component. And you can see this tumor is, we are removing with curette, ring curette, and it's coming out, and we will send for histopathology examination. And you can use two suction to remove this tumor gently and send for histopatho examination. And so this tumor is coming out. After removing this tumor, we will keep fat, then Abgel, then glue, then again we will keep the bony part of the septum, then Haddad flap. So this watertight closure will prevent any meningitis or CSF leak complication. So you can watch this video till the end so that you will come to know how we have done reconstruction. So this is unedited video of tumor removal. You can proceed till the end. Thank you so much.